Welcome to our service for Sunday the 21st of November. We start our service with the hymn, Come People of the Risen King. Let us pray. Lord, may we come as children of the risen King to celebrate the victory you have won over sin and death. In you all creation is healed and reconciled. Help us to enthrone Christ as King of our lives. We beg your forgiveness for the other kings that at times we kneel before, money, power, pleasure-seeking, self-righteousness, privilege. We seek your forgiveness, we who are imperfect and flawed in so many ways. May you strengthen us in our hearts and souls. May you inspire us as your people. Awaken in us a deep consciousness of your love for us, and a quiet confidence in the good purposes you have towards us, the good things you have prepared for each one of us who puts their trust in you and seeks to live for you in their daily lives. Help us to trust in you as the only King we need, and guide us in the days that lie before us. We thank you for your word, which is as a lamp to guide our path. May we lay it up in our hearts that we might not sin against you. May our faith be rooted and grounded in you as we strive to follow in the ways you have shown us, through the power of your Holy Spirit. Even as we pray and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever. Amen. Our first reading today is taken from the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verses 1 to 15. My child, don't forget what I teach you. Always remember what I tell you to do. My teaching will give you a long and prosperous life. Never let go of loyalty and faithfulness. Tie them around your neck, write them on your heart. If you do this, both God and people will be pleased with you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Never rely on what you think you know. Remember the Lord in everything you do, and he will show you the right way. Never let yourself think that you are wiser than you are. Simply obey the Lord and refuse to do wrong. If you do, it will be like good medicine, healing your wounds and easing your pains. Honor the Lord by making him an offering from the best of all that your land produces. If you do, your barns will be filled with grain, and you will have too much wine to store it all. My child, when the Lord corrects you, pay close attention and take it as a warning. The Lord corrects those he loves, as parents correct a child of whom they are proud. Happy is anyone who becomes wise, who comes to have understanding. There is more profit in it than there is in silver. It is worth more to you than gold. Wisdom is more valuable than jewels. Nothing you could want can compare with it. And then turning to Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 6, reading from verses 1 to 4. Again, reading from the Good News Bible. Children, it is your Christian duty to obey your parents, for this is the right thing to do. Respect your father and mother is the first commandment that has a promise added, so that all may go well with you, and you may live a long time in the land. Parents, do not treat your children in such a way as to make them angry. Instead, raise them with Christian discipline and instruction. come now to the last chapter of Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Our passage today is very much a continuation of the theme of chapter 5 and follows on from his teaching on the relationship between husbands and wives. That latter teaching is often seen as rather controversial because of its talk of wives submitting and the headship of the husband. And we asked the question in our last study in Ephesians as to whether that piece and the bit following on slaves and masters didn't just show that Paul's teaching was hopelessly out of date and bound up with the culture of the first century. And I made a strong argument for that not being the case at all, rather that Paul is trying to open up to us timeless truths. If you've been with us through our study of the earlier parts of the letter to the Ephesians, you'll know that Paul has been explaining all the way through the letter that what God's great plan for the universe is. And that is to bring all things under the headship of his Son, Jesus Christ. And integral to God's plan is God's church, his people who have been rescued through the saving work of Jesus on the cross and who are being made more and more into the likeness of Christ. We saw how Paul focuses on the headship of Christ as being a headship of love and submission and self-sacrifice. And we saw how the way God is making his people like himself is through the work of his Spirit, since all Christians are called to be filled with the Spirit. And it's by the power of the Spirit that we're called to go God's way. This passage is all about the outworking of these truths in the relationships of our daily lives. Paul first looks at the marriage relationship, the relationship between husbands and wives. Then he goes on to look at families, at home life, and then finally at working life, relationships between workers and their bosses. So we come today to look at family relationships, and Paul writes, "Children, it is your Christian duty to obey your parents, for this is the right thing to do. Respect your father and mother is the first commandment that has a promise added, so that all may go well with you and you may live a long time in the land. Parents, do not treat your children in such a way as to make them angry. Instead, raise them with Christian discipline and instruction." We also had a reading from Proverbs. The book of Proverbs is full of sound advice for both parents and children. We need to be familiar with what God says in an age when values are so muddled and a normal family almost doesn't exist. The wisdom we need is not the wisdom of the so-called experts, which has led to a culture that doesn't even know how to define family anymore. The wisdom we need is the wisdom from a God who designed the family in the first place. And while Paul in Ephesians was speaking especially to children under the age of majority, still living at home with their parents, I believe his words also broadly apply to grown-up children in their relationships with their parents, or to children in their relationship with their grandparents, and to grandparents in their relationship with their grandchildren. I think many people would agree that our children come into the world with a naturally self-centered approach to life and with a natural inclination to push against the boundaries. All of us do. We do not have to learn how to disobey. We must learn how to obey. We must learn the boundaries between right and wrong behavior. It is essential that right behavior be both taught by parents and learned by children if God's order for the home is going to be established. If that order is not established, then there will be constant strife. The Greek word that is translated obey comes from two words, under and to listen. It literally means to listen under. What is in view here is a conscious and deliberate listening. Listening so as to really hear. All too often our children practice what one might call selective hearing. They actually hear everything. They simply ignore what they don't want to hear. Ask them to tidy their room, and there's a good chance you'll get no response. But ask them what kind of ice cream they would like, and there's every chance they'll be all ears and quickly at your feet putting in their request. But why should children obey their parents? Firstly, quite simply, because this is the right thing to do, says Paul. This isn't just a Christian command. Almost every culture would agree that it is right for children to respect and obey their parents. And Paul does add one proviso, which the Good News Bible rather loses in its rendering of verse 1 as, "Children, it is your Christian duty to obey your parents." More accurately, it should be translated, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord," as the New International Version renders it. "In the Lord" means in the overarching context of what the Lord has commanded. Just as wives are not called to submit to their husbands when their husbands ask them to do immoral or unchristian things, so children are not required to obey parents who ask them to do unchristian things. If they were ever encouraged to lie or cheat or steal in order to get ahead, for instance, children should know in the Lord where their first obedience should lie, to the Lord and His commands. But there's another reason why children should obey their parents. Because it is commanded in the Ten Commandments, and is actually the only commandment with a promise, so that all may go well with you, and you may live a long time in the land. Really, what Paul is saying to children is that if their heart is right towards God, then they should want to honor and obey their parents. Their parents are not perfect. They are far from it and would probably admit it. But they will never make them perfect by rebelling against them. And they will only make life more difficult for themselves. Obedience is God's best way. You could even add that this is part of God's preparation for marriage. Every time children do something for their parents, they are preparing themselves for marriage. As they put their wishes aside for their parents' wishes, they become more self-sacrificing. As they learn to please their parents, they are learning how to please their possible future partners and not put self first. Good children are likely to become good marriage partners. Sociologists tell us we are likely to repeat our parents' mistakes. But God's commandment carries a promise. If we honor our father and mother, things will go well with us. It will enable us to break out of that negative cycle. If we learn to be Christ-like and submissive, however reasonable or unreasonable our parents are, then when we marry a partner who makes unreasonable demands, as every partner does from time to time, then we will have been well trained in our role. But then Paul writes, "Parents, don't treat your children in such a way as to make them angry. Instead, bring them up with Christian discipline and instruction." What are some of the ways in which we provoke our children to anger? One way is through unreasonableness. If we fail to consider what our children are capable of, and load them with too many demands, then we will give them a burden that they cannot bear. This will lead inevitably to frustration and anger. Fault-finding is another way we can provoke our children. This doesn't mean that we should never point out what is wrong, but that we take special care to point out what is right. It can be too easy just to criticize. As parents, we must learn how to encourage. Our children will respond much better to our criticism when we take time to compliment them on what they do well. Another cause of provocation might be inconsistency. If the ground rules change all the time, children become frustrated. And if parents don't present a united front, that will become a recipe for conflict and division in the home. I suspect, though, that one of the leading causes of angry, rebellious children is actually parents who don't demand obedience. Capitulating to the demands of tantrum-throwing kids won't make them happy. It will simply reinforce and encourage angry behavior as a means of getting their way. The TV program Super Nanny gave good examples of what happens when children get out of control and how to find a way to more positive family relationships. I well remember hearing of some young children out in the bush in Zimbabwe who had no discipline and structure in their lives, and their parents just couldn't control them. Then their parents got a nanny to come and live with them. Quickly, she installed order and boundaries in their lives and gave them freely of her time and her loving care, along with firm discipline when they misbehaved. When the time came for her to move on, the children were quite distraught, and the young girl burst out, "But who's going to tell us off now?" She had valued the security of the boundaries of what was right and wrong that the nanny had placed within her life. But there is one other important responsibility placed on parents: to bring their children up with Christian discipline and instruction. It is our responsibility to nurture, train, and instruct our children in what it means to follow Jesus. The greatest gift we can ever give our children is the desire to know Jesus Christ and His transforming power in their lives. To do that, we must use every opportunity to share with them by our lips and our lives just how important Jesus is to us. As we live before them, sharing God's living word with them, honestly admitting our faults and mistakes, genuinely seeking to be all God would have us be, then we will be doing all we can do to set them on the road to knowing Jesus as their Lord and Savior for themselves.
I want to walk with Jesus Christ all the days I live of this life on earth, to give to Him complete control of body and of soul. Follow Him, follow Him, yield your life to Him. Joy will then be mine. Follow Him, follow Him, yield your life to Him. He has conquered death, He is King of kings. Accept the joy which He gives to those who yield their lives to Him. I want to learn to speak of Him. My life must show that He lives in me. My deeds, my thoughts, my words must speak of all His love for me. Follow Him, follow Him, yield your life to Him. He has conquered death, He is King of kings. Accept the joy which He gives to those who yield their lives to Him. I want to learn.
Let us pray. Lord, help us all, young and old, to find a place of belonging within the family of your people, with Christ as the head, the one in whom we find our life. As Christ freely took the form of a servant and came amongst us as the servant king, so help us to learn better how to be servants of one another, not standing up for our rights, but seeking to let love govern all our actions and behavior. We thank you that we are not on our own as we seek to follow this path through life, but you come to us by your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and empower us. You can be our guide and help us discern the best way to go. You can give us insight into the things that are troubling other people and show us how best to encourage them and reassure them. We thank you, Lord, that we have the hope in Christ that you restore all things, that you will make all things new. We long for the day when evil will be judged and creation healed, and people of all nations and tribes and races will dwell together in peace and harmony. We pray that your light will triumph over the darkness and expose deceitfulness and all destructive forces that are damaging family life and relationships, and leading people made in your image to believe in false things. We pray for your Spirit to heal that which is broken and damaged, and wounded hearts to be nurtured in your love. Bless us today as your people, and help us to be more sensitive to you and to one another. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.